Welcome to a new Ideas Powered for Business talk. Did you know that the European Union stands at the forefront of the global clean tech revolution with a booming ecosystem of small and medium-sized enterprises dedicated to addressing the pressing environmental challenges? Clean tech SMEs play a pivotal role in advancing the EU's sustainability goals. As one of the big European confederations of small and medium-sized enterprises, European entrepreneur CEA-PME engages in promoting new opportunities for companies from all over the continent. Considering the urgent need for a fairer and greener transition, European entrepreneurs engages in supporting clean tech companies in Europe by helping them in finding funding and also integrating them into cross-border European supply and value chains. I'm happy to have with me today our special guest, Stefan Moritz from European entrepreneur CEA-PME and Thomas Hawklow from Kitemill, who will both give us some inspirational insights on how they navigate the green frontier. So my first question goes out to Stefan. Stefan, what emerging trends in clean tech do you find most exciting or promising?
Yeah, the emerging clean tech trends that we are expecting to become more and more important in the coming years are especially, of course, circular economy, net zero business management in itself as an approach, as an, a method, which is more important than the single technologies. Then, of course, also a low carbon impact construction, carbon capture, use and storage, including also artificial photosynthesis, but of course also still renewable energies. But we will here go beyond the, let's say, already a little bit traditional solar and wind energies. So like, for example, we will most probably see more developments in geothermal. And I hope very strongly that Iceland will be a big partner for us. In Europe also, hydrogen, of course, which will become cheaper, and last but definitely not least, airborne wind energy, like, for example, our colleague here from Kitemill and our member association, Airborne Wind Energy Europe, which we think also is a very interesting solution for very special areas in Europe and the world.
Thank you, Stefan. But how exactly does European entrepreneurs support clean tech startups such as Kitemill? What exactly can you do for them?
Now, as a European Confederation of SME Associations, first of all, our mission is to try to bring the interests of our member companies to the European institutions. Of course, that means trying to improve the legislation that is on the table or is already out there operating. In order to make business in Europe still a positive and attractive activity and to especially also enable our most innovative companies to be successful. But this also includes to promote more opportunities for our member companies. And we do that mainly through two activities. First of all, we started already 3 years ago with the Greener SME Internal Project, which includes different activities. One of it is the EU funding monitor that we send out every month, where we inform especially about green tech and clean tech funding opportunities from the programs Horizon Europe, LIFE, COSME, and Innovation Fund. And this funding monitor and newsletter that goes every month to all the members and users of our matchmaking platform called SME2B.eu, very simple, free of charge. You can subscribe very fastly and you can match here with other companies all over the continent and beyond from also other countries in the world. And then we invited also companies from our members to join us last year in a series of webinars that we called Innovate and Go to Market, because that is most probably one of the biggest challenges that many innovative companies have to then scale up and bring their products to market maturity. to be able to produce in series, to produce in scale, to save costs, of course, to be competitive, and to find clients, especially. And here we organize this series of webinars also as an exchange of experience, especially on clean tech like batteries, like hydrogen, like renewables. Here we are happy to help our companies to find ways on how to integrate into international value chains. Last but definitely not least, we are also partners since last year of our European Erasmus project on net zero business management, where we organize and will then run also mass online courses for business owners in managing from here to 2050 their transition to net zero business management.
Well, Stefan, there's so much that you are doing, and we are obviously providing all the links to all the many initiatives you just pointed out below in this video. Let me move to Thomas. Thomas, we are curious to know, how did actually the idea of your startup come about, and what motivated you to enter the clean tech space?
Yeah, we actually had a very, very exciting project going on. We were going to set a new world record on the fastest going sea vessel circumnavigating the Earth. And to accomplish this, we were going to use kite to propel the vessel. And we saw some great advantages in this kite. And my job in this project was to investigate potential industrial spin-offs that we're going to use in the marketing campaign of the project. And one of the areas we investigated was how we could use this technology to produce energy. And we saw some major advantages by handling the power with far less materials and reaching stronger, more consistent winds higher up, which was exactly what's going to propel the vessel and make us set the world record. So this encouraged us to spin off to kite mill and to energy production. And eventually this require all our focus. But I firmly believe that the world record will be beaten by kites soon. But we have a much more important task to solve now.
Well, that's very, very encouraging, Thomas. And I wish you obviously all the best for meeting this world record. But what is the exact environmental or sustainable challenge Kitemill is addressing? And I'm curious to find out, how do you actually assess the environmental impact of your clean tech solution?
Yes, so we are developing a wind power plant. So we are using the kites to produce energy from the wind. And by doing that, we are lining up the forces smarter and handling the same power as a conventional turbine with less material. And we reach higher up so we can increase production. That will, of course, reduce the problem with intermittency that you see from other energy or renewable sources. And this, again, position airborne wind to be potentially a game-changing technology that could be enabling net zero by 2050. It could become a dominant energy production technology. And by that, of course, means that we are measuring our impact in the amount of gigaton of abated CO2. We could measure it in also in saved materials in energy production, but of course, the biggest impact will be on the CO2.
Listening to you, Thomas, obviously my mind is drawn immediately to the potential intellectual property in your business. All these innovations that you just mentioned, how do you actually, or what is your approach as to protecting them?
Yeah, so we founded a company based on this. We went to the inventor of kites for kitesurfing and secured exclusive rights for the patents and continue working with that inventor, Bruno Legiano, to develop our solution. After our first test showed the potential and it really beat our expectations, we saw that we could improve endurance of these kites by moving to more rigid systems. So we did a very tough decision to abandon these IP rights. And since that, we have been, of course, inventing and applying our own IP, securing our own IP, but we have also been acquiring and merge with companies that also had strong IP, and this represents our IP portfolio today. And today, of course, we are representing a new deep tech, and it's always a danger to end up on the sidetrack with the technology. So in this phase, while we are still securing more technology rights, it's more about freedom to operate, and we would like to collaborate with other players in the field to make sure that our solutions and our choices become the industrial standard for the industry.
I would now like to ask the two of you a question regarding how do you see the primary challenges that clean tech startups such as Kitemill face in Europe today, and how are these startups actually navigating the obstacles that drive the sustainable innovation? Let me begin with Stefan.
Yeah, I mean, from our point of view, that what we get back as a feedback from our partners and companies is that, of course, the increasing legislative burden that is produced by the European Union and by the member states, which often then do a so-called gold plating, that means even making legislative burden more cumbersome, more strict on national levels, using the European decisions as an excuse. It is Brussels' will, and so on. That limit, indeed, let's say, of course, the time that you can dedicate to develop, market, and use some technologies. But of course, also certain policies try to promote certain technologies instead of others. We need more open technological openness in order to make different solutions possible, because the world is very, very various, and we need a high number of good solutions and only one or two. Then, of course, we have a problem with high upfront investment needs for new technologies, and that often clashes with the requirements from the banks, which need also high own capital requirements as collaterals, as guarantees for the companies. European founders, startups, SMEs, they mainly do and want to be financed by market bank, commercial banks. They don't go to the stock markets, which, by the way, is also not so easy. But even if you if they could go, they don't want to, because they want to continue to be the owners of the company, of the idea that they are promoting, and that requires really. Of course, the European Union is doing something here with guarantees by the European Investment Fund, by InvestEU, the program, but also intellectual property as an asset to give it as a guarantee to banks is interesting. So that has to be definitely be more developed in order that we can help here the companies to start to invest in this new technologies which are required for our future.
Thomas, can you confirm what Stefan just laid out? What is your real life experience?
Yeah, for sure. Stefan is spot on what we need. We are introducing a new energy technology that is going to be enabled globally in a large scale. These things are not happening often, and it requires us to do quite a lot. We have to create more like a global mega trend for investors to make it happen. We need to have policymakers, regulatory bodies, and not at least the funding bodies onto this game. And there is a huge task that have to happen globally. We are born global, and the competition will happen where the incentives are the strongest. And we would, of course, like to compete in our home market. So we are working very hard to secure the support we need to create European industrial leadership and to be able to develop ourselves here.
You know, the very reason that we are doing these Ideas Powerful Business Talks is exactly to give a voice to, in this case, to European entrepreneur and to Kitemill, to speak also on behalf of many other clean tech startups, and to reinforce the messages you just said. I have a last question to the two of you. How do you see the clean tech landscape evolving over the next 5 to 10 years in Europe, And what role do startups play in shaping this future? Let me start this time with Thomas.
Yeah, so there need to happen changes. We need to accelerate things. And we experience a lot of problems with established policy established processes. Of course, the policymakers have to focus on action, and new technology and new inventions might not be that easy to talk about when you want to have actions. But I think everybody realizes now that we need new technology. We need things that can accelerate the development, so we are not stuck with the progress rate that we have now, that obviously not are good enough to reach our goals. Mm.
Stefan, last but not least, what is your look into the crystal ball? How do you see the situation in 5 to 10 years from now?
I see that it is definitely necessary, as Thomas pointed out, that we accelerate, and that means for us that we make a better work to combine the good ideas, the great developments, and also the product tests that have been run by many European startups with the experience and capacity to produce, to make out of these ideas and products new markets, new products that also produce added value and income. That means that from the startup scene, we expect, let's say, also more availability to partner with small and medium-sized enterprises, which are maybe very good in chasing opportunities, in finding clients, markets, boost the sales, because you have to sell your product. You have to not only to finance it by somebody that gives you money, but you sell it, and with that you can improve also your scale up. You can open new service and sales channels and grow step by step. That is very important. Let's say here, a partnership between those who have ideas and those who can implement and solve problems. Of course, the EU has to play here its cards in the right way. We will try to become more green, but we need also to become more competitive in the world. So it is also a question of being cheap, being fast, being of high quality, and having many partners in the world with many markets where we can enter and participate actively like other players.
Well, I certainly learned a lot today, and I would like to really warmly thank you for your valuable insights. And I would like to say goodbye and see you all soon again in a new Ideas Powered for Business talk.
Thank you very much, Sabina.
Thank you for inviting me. Mm.